Indeed, the more a Tzelem Elokim a person becomes as he was created to be, as the pasuk says in Bereishis, God made man the Tzelem Elokim in his image. He created him in the image of God. And there can be nothing more glorious for man to achieve than this. And therefore, even the clothing that the Kohen Gadol wore expressed this idea. Because anyone who saw the Kohen Gadol was instantly reminded of this trait of Hod, glory, and of how the only way to be truly glorious is to become a Tzelem Elokim, to live in the image of God, which means developing your own greatness by becoming devoted to the development of that of others. That's the path to your own greatness. And we see this historically. We see it, we document it, we write books about it, we make movies about it, but the rest of us don't believe it. We go, wow, this amazing person, but I can't, like, that's not my life, I can't do that. I'll die, I'll explode, I'll blow up, I'll disappear, I'll go poof. He can do that, and we honor him, and we cherish him, and we use him, you know, but when it comes to me, you know, we don't make the connection between us and that person that we're honoring. So this, right, is true fear of God. This is true simcha. When a person does that, they achieve the true simcha. And that was Moshe Rabbeinu. And that was the lesson of the man. Why? For the main eternal point of the man was yesh. The Hebrew word yesh means what you have. The gematria of the word Omer is spelled in the Torah. The Torah says the Jewish people ate man for 40 years until they came to inhabited land. They ate man until they came to the border of Canaan. And Omer, which is spelled in the Torah, right? Really, hey, I am Memresh, but the Vav is missing, is a tenth part of an ephah. So it's a measurement. But the word Omer should be spelled Ayin Vav Memresh, and instead it's spelled Ayin Memresh with the Vav missing. It's chaser, right? In other words, the man stated explicitly, you have what you have, and nothing more, right? But that is all you need, and equal to what everyone else has, even if only relatively speaking. It was the Yeshli Kol that Yaakov told Esav when they met, right? The confrontation, Yaakov versus Esav, and Esav, you know, Yaakov gives the gift, and Esav says, no, keep whatever's yours, my brother, I don't need it. And Esav, you know, and Yaakov says, Yeshli Kol, as Rashi explains, it means Yeshli Mespeak, I have all that I need. Esav says, Yeshli Rav, I have more than I need, you know, and in the end, Esav keeps the gift. But the point that Yaakov is making at this point in time is that whatever I have is all that I need because God takes care of me, right? That's what he says. How could he know, right? Because he knew God, Yaakov knew God, and God knew him, and that's all he had to know. Thus, when the rabbis teach, who is a wealthy person, one who is satisfied with his portion, they weren't just giving sound financial advice. They were arming us against the greatest enemy of our time, Amalek, and his descendant Haman, who can only take advantage of people who stop serving God with simcha. People who fail to live by the message of man. That's the whole vulnerability. If you live up to the lesson of the man of Yesh, Amalek can't get to you. Amalek sows discontent, right? For it is the role of Amalek to breed dissatisfaction, greed, jealousy, discontentment, and ultimately depression. It was the role of Moshe Rabbeinu to do just the opposite. And one of the most important messages he taught the Jewish people in the battle against Amalek by going up the mount and holding his arms up and being physically involved in this battle and not rely upon major miracles is that simcha is something that we have to create and not wait for it to fall from heaven. We have to make the first move. The secret? Moshe Rabbeinu. How? By understanding his essential trait, which in Sfiris language is Netzach. The word Netzach means eternity, but it can also mean victory. And though these words may not be terms that one would immediately associate with Moshe Rabbeinu, they are in fact the most accurate descriptions of who he was, the ultimate winner, because everything he did was for the sake of eternity. The emotional side of victory is obvious every day of life. However, the philosophical side is less considered. and it is the most important part because it is what determines the definition of true victory. Believe it or not, most victories throughout history have been only pseudo-victories and therefore come to mean very little over time. In a simple competition, victory means continuity, right? The victor in any match earns the right to continue his struggle for supremacy in that which he competes, while the loser is forced to bow out of the contest at least until the next one. However, even victory in this case can be short-lived and lose meaning over time. Such victories are tastes of eternity. Sports match, you know, sports competition, winning the finals, right? It's a taste of eternity, which is what makes them so exciting on a deeper level, but they are not eternity itself. But overcome the Yitzhahara and do a mitzvah or avoid a sin, and that is not only victory, but even an eternal one. It is a victory that can pay you in this world and in the world to come. Indeed, the Talmud says that even a sin cannot wipe away the merit of doing a mitzvah. Only the regret a person may have had for doing it. If a person regrets doing a mitzvah, chas v'chalil, for whatever reason, that can wipe away the mitzvah they did. But if they like the mitzvah, they accept the mitzvah they've done, they want that mitzvah, and they can't help themselves to do a chet at some point in time, a sin, they will not undo the mitzvah that they did, right? So this was the basis of Moshe Rabbeinu's greatness. He lived in this world, but he was totally invested in the next one. At first, his own brother, Aaron, and his sister, Miriam, thought it was to a fault he was invested in the next world. As it says, Miriam and Aaron complained about Moshe regarding the Cushi, right, Zipporah, the woman he married. They said, does God speak only to Moshe? Has he not also spoken to us? Meaning they were also prophets, were also, you know, dealing in eternal matters over here, so why is Moshe so cut off in the physical world? But God himself set the record straight. He said to them, listen to me. To the prophets amongst you, when I appear, I reveal myself only in a vision and speak in a dream. Not so with my servant Moshe, who is the most trusted in all my house. With him I speak face to face while he is conscious, and not in riddles. He has a true vision of God. How could you not be afraid to speak negatively about my servant Moshe? That is the trait of Netzach. Living with the reality that this world is but a corridor to the next one, as it says in Pirkei Avos, right? This is not the main event. The main event is Olam Haba, what to come. There's only a passage to that next world. This means pursuing materialism only for the sake of enhancing one's spiritual position. To one rooted in Netzach, it is only natural to place physical pleasure secondary to spiritual pleasure. Not, perhaps, to the extent that Moshe Rabbeinu did, or had to, in order to be able to remain on the level of prophecy, but to the extent that one's decisions clearly reflect an emphasis on the spiritual. You can tell by the way people live and how they act, and the decisions that we make, how spiritual we are in our approach to life. A netzach-oriented person will always ask, when partaking of frivolous material pleasures, is it really worth it in the long run, spiritually speaking? You know, you have to ask these questions.